Hey, thank you so much for that beautiful intro, Paulie. It was so lovely to have you host this session, and let's mix it up. There's no rule book around how anything works. Throw it out. Let's do a check-in before an agenda. It was absolutely beautiful. And yeah, your introduction was so amazing as well. And on behalf of everyone here, I would also like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land. I'm in this little wooden cabin overlooking the ocean on a cliff at the moment down in Kilcunda, and I'm on the land of the Wadarung people and would like to pay my respects to their elders, past and present. Also acknowledge wherever you are tuning in from today. I'm so grateful that you're tuning in here today. What an absolute honor to have you carve out time to be present with the community collective and the legendary Brett. It's been really cool to see the pop-up community popping off in LinkedIn group. Was it annoying? Was it helpful? Was it cool? Please share some feedback afterwards. We'd love to hear, because it really was a new idea to actually help you connect and build your own network as community builders, as people who are pioneering in this space. And, you know, it's really cool to actually connect today and have Brett here. Brett and I were introduced through another legend, Brian, who is the founder of Hockey Stick Advisory. He's built some incredible communities, and he just put you and I, Brett, actually in the LinkedIn group. He was like, you two legends need a chat. I was like, oh, all right, let's jump on a call, Brett. And when I heard your story, I just thought, wow, we've got to share this with our members and people who are building and growing new communities. And that is really why we're here today. It is to learn. And so I'm going to introduce Brett. We're going to then hear a little bit from the legend himself. So if this is your first time kind of meeting Brett, he is a master of many different things. And, you know, it sounds like for the past kind of 14 to 16 months, you've been the community director at kiwiSaas, which is really the home of NZ's SaaS's SaaS business founders, directors, leaders, and their teams. And it's been this secondment for you where, you know, you kind of just joined this team, built a new community alongside kind of Rich Millington, and then back to your old role you go. And that was kind of the story I heard. And there's a lot more into that. But it also sounds like you started your career as an engineer for Air New Zealand. You've had senior leadership and tech roles at Microsoft. You co-founded a business strategy consultancy at Business IQ, and also being the chief executor of Cucumber Digital. I was about to say of cucumber, but it's definitely not just a vegetable. So that is really awesome to hear. And so, yeah, you're a jack of all trades, a master of many things. And it's just really cool to see how you've built this strong reputation as both, you know, like this left field kind of thinker, but also this strategic ally of how you just attack problems and grow a team with just like positivity, humor, and grace. And so with all of that in mind, Brett, I'd love for you to take the stage, share some insights today. But first, how are you? How are you going, Brett?
I'm good, thank you. That is an incredible, I'm going to get you to record that for me, and I'm going to use that in the future. That was way more than was deserved. So I'm good, thank you. I'm horribly disfigured after a terrible mixed martial art accident. That's a complete lie. I was actually playing VR games on Saturday night, and I had a couple of drinks and managed to face plant in a cabinet. So don't do that. I'm looking forward to filling the accident compensation form in just to see what they think of that. Let me kick off. So a few things up front. kiwiSaas is a government-funded initiative to grow the software as a service sector in New Zealand. The software as a service companies are the likes of Canva or Xero or Netflix is one, companies that deliver their services mostly over the internet via software. And the potential opportunity for New Zealand is huge. One of the things I want to point out up front, and it's actually my last slide too, this has been a team sport. Whilst I might have fronted a lot of the community stuff or most of the community stuff, the team itself was 7 in size. And the three things that kiwiSaas was set up to do was 1, build community, 2, build capability, and 3, provide insight, both for the industry itself, so the companies could benchmark themselves and understand more about how they were performing compared to competitors and sectors and other things, but also, very importantly, to channel information from the community back into government, who, until we set this up, really had no idea about what was happening within the sector. They just see the the tech sector or the digital sector as one big bucket with all of these things stirred into it. And that includes everything from the likes of Xero, New Zealand's largest SaaS company, through to companies, you know, the corner store that fixes iPad screens. So so those are the three things we were set up to do. And I very fortunately was asked to front the first one of those and be the inaugural community director. I should also note that it was the first community director role I'd ever stepped into. So I admire their bravery. So what I thought I'd do is put together a slide deck or presentation that just kind of, I think meanders would not be unfair, its way through a couple of the key points, things that I learned along the way. Picture yourself as me back, you know, 16, 18 months back, stepping into this role. I literally knew nothing about community. I'll be open and upfront about that. No, I had some viewpoints and opinions. And I was talking to Paz earlier around foresight and hindsight. There's a bunch of stuff I've learned along the way, and hopefully I'll impart some of that through this. So the first thing, he says, clicking the right thing, is that community is a science. Now, I talked to a lot of folks about community. And interestingly, I talked to a number of folks that I, at the time, viewed as being thought leaders or certainly experts around community. But what I did not get from any of them was the understanding that this is very much a science-based thing that, we were about to embark upon. There was a lot of talk of people skills. There was a lot of talk of once you get it spun up, it's all good. It's just a matter of maintaining it then, you know. It sounded pretty darn easy, which caused some concern on my part. They made it sound easier than it really was. And I was surprised at the lack of, I guess, scientific rigor. That might be a bit overcalling it, but you know, again, as Paz said, I'm a engineer by heart, by trade. There just seemed to be some sort of tangibility that was lacking in it. So one of the things that I've learned along the way, it is absolutely a science and should be treated as such. It's a science that involves people, but I think if you approach it as a people thing first and a scientific thing later, I personally would argue that's not quite the right way around. I think it is an engineering challenge, first and foremost, to do with bringing people together and helping them engage. And for the purposes of kiwiSaas, Richard Millington was our scientist, and I also need to be clear up front, we have not had any direct, or we've had minimal direct contact with Richard Millington. We bought and distributed to all of the team his book, you know, Build Your Community, and that became our Bible. My copy, in fact, I've been through a couple of them now, I've managed to lose one on a plane somewhere, was probably more highlighter than it was just black and white. And the thing with Richard Millington, we found Richard Millington probably a month or so into our journey of building the community. The thing with Richard Millington was that he, for me and for the others, brought that science aspect to it. The you know, about using information and data, that you needed to approach this in a structured, formulaic manner, if you wanted to make this work, and most importantly, make it sustainable. I think it's not relatively easy, but you can spin something up and that's magic, but the real magic is in keeping it spun up. So Richard Millington was effectively our chief scientist, and we had lots of meetings where the team would sit around and there would be something that we were trying to, some gnarly issue we were trying to solve, and we'd figure out from one of Millington's videos or his book or whatever, you know, what we should do, and we would head down that path. Those of you that are parents have probably discovered one of the joys of parenthood is that everyone has an opinion. Even those that don't have children have an opinion about bringing children up. And one of the things I've got three kids in their 20s. One of the things I worked out early on was just pick someone to listen to, just one person. So in our case, otherwise, everyone's got an opinion. It all gets rather confusing. We just settled on Richard, and that seemed to serve us quite well. Next slide. I think it's really important to be able to answer these questions, strongly answer these questions, right? Now, when we set up, decided that we would, as one of the three initiatives around kiwiSaas, that we would set a community up, the reason we did that was that we went out and talked to literally 100 New Zealand SaaS companies and asked them what was missing. And one of the first things that came up, and one of the things that came up repeatedly, was that sense of community. And just to give you an idea of how much that was lacking, the joke I make about SaaS companies is that they're like budgies and humans. They look very, very different from the outside, but they share about 95% of their DNA. And they really do. It really doesn't matter if you're working for a Xero or a Canva or a Pushpay or a Netflix or a whoever. The roles, the jobs, the responsibilities, the way things work in those businesses are so incredibly similar, it's spooky, even though they're playing in entirely different domains. So when we're out talking to all of these SaaS companies, none of them saw themselves as being a sector or a community of similar companies. They really didn't see any similarity or any cause. They didn't see a tribe. And once we started talking to them and pointing some of these things out, they started to click that actually, oh, there's someone like me that's working at a company that's nothing like mine, but their job's exactly the same as mine. So it became clear to us, there was an imperative to build this community. So we knew why we were doing this. I've spoken to people since who are tasked with or keen to build their own communities. And I've been genuinely surprised at the number of times they haven't been able to answer that first question, right? Or that there's a very thinly veiled commercial reason that they're doing it. And I struggle to see the value for the community members in, if they were to fire up a community. What does success look like? So it's all very well to build this thing and navigate it somewhere, but where exactly are you navigating towards? So for us, success looked like building a community of, I think our goal was 5,000 members by the end of June 2025. I think we're about 1,400 into that now after about 18 months. That there would be an active forum, that we would build a resources library that was well used, and that we would have people messaging within the platform that we chose to connect, with one degree of separation with their peers. They wouldn't have to go to someone that was a common contact on LinkedIn and go, hey, A, can you introduce me to B? You just send the email or whatever it might be. So success for us was a community that were helping each other. Those ahead of you on the journey in the SaaS world look like experts to you, and you look like an expert to those behind you. So we wanted a open, safe space specifically for SaaS practitioners, leaders, and founders, where people knew that they could open up and ask tricky, challenging questions without being judged or ridiculed or whatever. And of course, if you're going to set up metrics like that, or success measures like that, you need to figure out what it is you're going to measure. And I have to say that the measurement and determination of success was one of the most frustrating aspects I've found of the role. What does engagement look like? People, engagement is one of those, I know you use that word a lot, but I'm not sure you know what it means, words, right? It's a bit like productivity and innovation. So what are you going to measure? How are you going to measure it? I think critical considerations as well. And I guess aligned very closely to that previous slide is about being data-driven, always data-driven. And that came from the top, the guy that leads the kiwiSaas Initiative. His name's Bruce Jarvis, a Callaghan Innovation colleague of mine. That's where I met him. He's a product-centric guy and very, very data-driven. So we had a lot of conversations, and I tend to be a wave my arms around in the air kind of guy, and I think this, and I've seen this, and my gut feel is that. And Bruce would just keep coming back to, what's the data telling us? What's the data telling us? And it was an incredibly good discipline to drive into the team, because it enabled us to try things, experiment, measure things, and learn. As I said, we're a government-funded organisation. The kiwiSaas effectively reports in through an organisation called New Zealand Trade and Enterprise, NZTE. And that, it was interesting dealing with other government departments who have a tendency, the way in which public sector tends to work is, we're going to build this thing, go and build this thing. You might learn over the 2 or 3 years it takes you to build that thing that the thing that you built isn't necessarily the thing that's needed, but go and build that thing anyway, right? So they're all about inputs and not about outcomes. We were very much about outcomes. So we were more along the lines of, we're heading towards a destination, but how we get there will change and vary as we learn along the way. And that really did freak out a number of the folks in the public sector. That's not the way they like to operate. But what we found was, if we could back our decision making up with data, they love that. And so getting people to understand, buy in, effectively fund, I guess, but support what we were doing, we found that being able to present them with real data, not superlatives, not this is going to be great, this is going to be better, this is going to be big, we're going to do these things faster or more effectively, which are all lovely, but we had hard data to show them. And one of the decisions we had to make early on and we reviewed many times throughout the journey was who's in this community and who's not, right? Because I think it's easy, particularly when you set a goal of how many people you'd like in the community, to start getting fuzzy around the edges about who should and should be in, right? Oh, we'll turn a blind eye to that. Maybe they're not quite the right people, but we've got to get our numbers up, right? That's really important. For us, the community was always for SaaS practitioners, those that work in the industry in SaaS companies, those who have founded these companies, and those who lead these companies. That was the community. We then, probably 6-8 months down the track, went through a review process of that and thought, well, what about people who wish to get into the industry or switch from others into this? And so we changed some of the entry criteria and what those folks could access. And right at the beginning, we'd made a call that we wouldn't let investors into the community. We didn't. We thought that some of the founders in particular would not like to see their laundry being aired in public in some ways to those who might be at some point looking at investing in them. But what was interesting was probably 6 or 8 months into that journey, we went out and talked to some of those founders and that fear that they had at the beginning was no longer a particular concern to them. And so we decided that we would let SaaS active and experienced, so there's still some criteria around it, SaaS investors into our gated community, which is called kiwiSaas Central. And I think one of the most powerful exercises we went through was before we launched kiwiSaas Central. So we were actively, we'd built mailing lists and other things like that, but we hadn't actually launched our place on the web at that stage. Was we built an ecosystem map about what else was out there. Because there's something I've learned through a bunch of years in the business world and the tech world. And the analogy I use is it takes a very small lead weight to hold down a very large helium balloon. You'd be amazed at how the tiniest amount of someone digging their toes in somewhere can make your job several degrees removed from that difficult. And when you start to map out the world of communities in the tech sector, there are a gazillion of them. There, you know, we have NZ Tech in New Zealand, which is a large umbrella organization. There's a lot of specialist communities and generalist communities. We even map where, you know, the likes of Google might fit in. How much do people use Google to go and answer their SaaS related questions, etc. We probably spent the better part of a month to 6 weeks over time building this map, and it was multidimensional. Effectively looking at the breadth of capability or information that a specific community might have versus their reach. Is it New Zealand specific? You know, we're very clear about being a New Zealand specific SaaS community. Was it more generalist or more broad than that? And the reason I found this to be a really important exercise was it literally gave me a picture of where the heck we fitted. And it was like fitting pieces into a jigsaw puzzle, because I suspect this happens elsewhere, not just a little old New Zealand. One of the things I've definitely learned over the years is if anyone thinks you're coming close to encroaching on them, that lead weight and helium balloon thing will go on. You know, people, you know, the folks that have been, you know, singing your praises loudly and looking forward to you entering the marketplace, all of a sudden will turn from, you know, promoters to detractors or whatever it might be. And we really wanted people to understand that we weren't building this to eat someone else's lunch. We were there to fix a market failure. And that market failure was that there was no commercial reason that someone would set this up. So it hadn't been set up, so we didn't have the community, and we felt the community was really important to go and build, you know, a longer term SaaS industry in New Zealand. You know, we are doing this for the betterment of New Zealand's economy long term. I'm doing this for my kids, right? Literally, or was doing it. So that idea of building an ecosystem map is really powerful, and I honestly can't recommend that enough. That was just a bright light bulb going off once we got it completed. There was a lot of interesting and fractious conversations along the way, I'll be honest. But we knew why we were doing what we were doing, and we knew where we were where we fitted into the great big jigsaw puzzle, and we could articulate that to others. And so the minute anyone's tackle started to get up, we could tell them why we weren't eating their lunch, and it really did make a difference. And you also need a personality, and this is kind of this is a very much a personal take on things. I quite deliberately brought my personality to the role of community director because I think, you know, we are government funded. I think there was the potential or a danger, albeit a relatively low risk, of you could go and build something that sounds and looks a bit governmenty, to be frank. And you know, just between us, I'm not sure that's really what the SaaS community in New Zealand were looking for. So I have a bit of personality. I've got a bit of a sense of humour. I've got a different way of looking at things, and I tried to bring that to the equation where possible and where applicable, where appropriate. And I think that worked. I think, and it wasn't about making kiwiSaas central and our you know, any communications I was involved in about me, but it was about making it feel like everyone else in the community were dealing with someone or seeing someone that was kind of like them. And I think that was the right thing to do. And I think so, and this is where the whole thing around building community gets interesting. I truly do believe it's a science, but you're dealing with people. And I do think you need, if you're going to be at the sharp pointy end of this, the visible end of this, I think having that personality and willingness to deal with folks is an important part of the equation. And as I said at the beginning, for kiwiSaas, it was a team sport, right? There were seven in the team, or are seven in the team. I have never worked so intensely in my life. Actually, that's not true. It's a long time prior to that role. It would be a long time since I'd worked that intensely. There were so many moving parts in this. No one had ever done this before anywhere, let alone little old New Zealand. We were dealing at one end with government who, to be honest, don't necessarily, you know, there isn't a broad understanding of what we're doing and why. It's kind of niche and specialist. We were learning as we were doing. So there was experimentation going on, and some of those experiments worked wonderfully, and some of those were slightly less wonderful. And we accepted that. You know, all of the people in the team come from a public sector background, but actually also very, very strong commercial sector experience as well. So we had a foot in both camps. So we had in the team Bruce, who leads it, who spent a very large chunk of his time being the, don't quote me on this, the shit umbrella, you know, making sure that anything that flowed downwards out of government, the public sector, only went as far as it needed to. He shielded us from a lot of the bureaucracy and, you know, back and forthing and all the other bits and pieces. Dan Bloom, who's our Marcon's director, is just an incredible woman from the point of view of the stuff that she had rattling around her head and her ability to get stuff done. Kim Ellis, who ran our events side of things. We had two product managers, Matt and Marco, for the capability development and the insight and benchmarking stuff. So it was it was very much a team sport. I got to be at the front pointy end of it, for better or for worse. At times that was exhilarating. You know, wow, look at the stuff we're doing. At other times it was, oh my God, I have no idea what I'm doing and I'm not enjoying this as much as I thought I might. But for us, it really was a team sport. And so I just want to make that really clear that whilst I got to front a lot of this and thoroughly enjoyed that, because I like talking, because you didn't work that out. The only reason that we got the stuff done that we did in the way that we did and have achieved some of the successes we've achieved is because, you know, I got to be the bit of the iceberg that stuck out of the water, but there was a lot of other folks that were, you know, under it. And that's all the slides I've got. So I'm happy to, honestly, it's an ongoing learning experience. I can't stress strongly enough just how, what I thought community was about and how I would do this at the beginning of it changed dramatically over the span of the time that I was in the role. And I got, you know, a lot more intuitive around things. We had some really good, robust discussions amongst the team at times, things that I thought needed to be done, challenges that I things that I thought we could do better or differently. I would be lying if I said that everyone agreed with me violently all the time. That is absolutely not true. We had some good, stand-up, strong, robust conversations about things. But again, as a team, I think it was we're a good team and it worked well. And so that's it. Thank you for coming to my TED talk for those slides. And I'm happy to answer any questions, take any feedback. Go for your life.
Ah, oh, thank you, Brett. I love this TED talk. TED talk times the CC. That's so fun. And yeah, thank you so much for sharing more about your journey. It's so helpful to hear how you approached it, but also the decisions that you made. You know, in just over 12 months, the community had reached such great growth, like over 1,000 members. You had some really great goals of that 5,000 members in June 2025. Like, I love how clear it has been, a very Rich Millington, in that it's very data driven, very clear cut. And I can just see that through a lot of the strategy. And it was just so inspiring to hear that, you know, it's been a team effort. You understood exactly who you were serving, what the goals that you're trying to understand. And then you found a mentor to help you on the way. It was like, Rich, great. You're the guru in our world. Let's do this thing. And it's been this ongoing learning journey. So, oh, such a great springboard to really dive into some Q&A. And so how this is going to work for anyone here live, you are so welcome to jump into the queue and click I have a question and ask your question live. And for any question that is posted in the chat, I'll ask them on your behalf. So we've got three already, but I will just tease out a couple things from your story before we go into that, Brett, because we had quite a few people in the registration process actually ask some questions about, you know, how do you actually find and attract the right members, and how do you show potential members the value of your community? I know Alexis and Sandra were really kind of asking these in the registration, so I'd love to just tease that out. You know, you spoke to 100 NZ companies. What's your thoughts there?
Yeah, so that's great questions. And in fact, I that slide I had in there around why are you doing this actually came from that. There were a couple of things that kind of surprised me along the way. You can have, or my experience was, you can have an amazing value proposition for potential community members, and it can still be like hammering nails into concrete, getting them to join. And at one stage, I had a call down list of about 300 names. One of the things I should point out is the platform that we built, kiwiSaas Central, on top of this thing called Hivebrite. And Hivebrite has an interesting sign-up process. It's a two-stage sign-up process, and there's a whole bunch of legal hoo-ha with us being in a government organisation that we had a somewhat convoluted sign-up process. And so we often lost people at the end of the first stage. They didn't complete the second and they didn't join. And so I went and called a whole lot of those folks. And it was quite amazing, the number of them I spoke to that effectively said, oh, yeah, I'm well aware of kiwiSaas. Yeah, it looks awesome. Oh, man, I'm sure I'd get a lot of value out of that. Well, why haven't you joined up? Oh, I've been busy, haven't got around to it. I must have missed an email, da 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 da. And so you can, the premise that you can build it and they will come, I think is deeply flawed. And I would not rely on that if you're going to build a community. If you build it, you might need to drag them kicking and screaming through the front door. Might be a better description. What was the second part of that question, Beth? Sorry, there was the. How do you bring them? What was
the... Yeah, and then it's how you attract them and then showing the potential value, you know, like if the value proposition isn't enough just to say like, hey, this is the value you're going to get, like how do you really ingrain that in them?
Yep. So when we went out and spoke to those 100 companies before we fired this up, one of the threads that came through, there was a lot of stuff that came through, but as we kind of distilled things down, one of the threads that came through was they felt that they... could benefit from a safe place to ask questions, right? And again, the interesting thing around building a SaaS company is that no matter what kind of sector or segment you're targeting, the journey is very similar. You know, the journey from a bright idea over a couple of glasses of wine on a Friday night through to a $1 billion exit is surprisingly similar for lots of companies. You know, you've got to build a minimum viable product and all the other bits and pieces. And so the folks we talked to understood that there was a great opportunity to share in the knowledge of others, to tap into the insight of others. And so that looks as quite a clear value prop, right? So we made it from the get-go. We had a forum where people could post those questions. Just recently, we've enabled folks to post those questions anonymously. But what's interesting is that people don't have problems every single day of their working lives. And so when you've got that problem, it's like, oh yeah, actually I should join up. This is a good thing to do. But if actually things are cruising along and you're going too badly, the value proposition isn't really there, right? And so we would go through these kind of waves of people posting questions, and then it would just be crickets for a week or two or three. And then, you know, sometimes I'd post questions just to get conversations going and tag folks into them. And then there'd be this, that's it, exactly. And then there'd be a whole bunch more questions again, out of nowhere, left field, completely different questions from people that never asked them before. And so I think working on the assumption that you're going to build this community, and everyone in your community is going to get up every morning and go, oh, it's so good to be a member of that community. That really is making my life better. I think you're kidding yourself. I think for portions of their day or their lives or whatever, there is value in being there, but don't kid yourself that you're top of mind. And we used to talk quite a bit, certainly the last few months I was with the team, around the top of mindness and maintaining top of mindness. Relevance is the key word. And I think building a community that is relevant, you know, we had 90% of our folks were, you know, quiet, silent learners. They would sit in the background, you know, I think some Millington numbers, 9% of them were fairly active. And 1% was super engaged. You know, they were the ones asking lots of questions, networking with others and all that sort of thing. So I think the value varies over time with the individual over time. And you shouldn't kid yourself otherwise. You know, you're not you're not the center of the universe, and it's important not to think that you are, and just be building that value. But what that means, one of the things I really did learn, was, you know, at times when the forum was quiet and there wasn't much traffic happening on other things, and you know, we weren't getting a lot of click through on emails, it was easy to feel that we were losing something, that something was slipping away from us, that something was dissipating, and then bam, a week later it would be all full on. It's like, and so I got used to not worrying as much about sometimes that lack of engagement. It used to freak others in the team out. It'd be like, oh, you know, what do we need to do? It's like, don't worry, you know, we don't need to manufacture questions in a forum. When people have them, they'll ask. They know where to find us. But I'll have to be honest and say, bringing people into the community after we'd built it all, we spent a huge amount of time building it behind the scenes before we launched, is still hard. You know, I think at the moment they're adding maybe 10 or 20 folks a week, something like that. Every single person I've ever spoken with has gone, oh, this is awesome. This is great. Oh, I'm really pleased you built this. This is fantastic. Have you joined? Oh, no, I haven't. You know, by the way, I should note, it's free to join. There's no fees in this.
Yeah.
So, humans are funny. That's what I've learned.
Yeah, and that point on relevance is so relevant. You know, I think that I remember the early days of the Community Collective. I literally jumped on one-on-one phone calls with over 50 different community builders at the very start saying, hey, what are your challenges? What are you trying to achieve? What are your goals? How can we help you do that? Great. I'm thinking about starting a group. Do you want to join? Here's the link. Pop your email in. I'll let you know. You're making it so easy for people to step into that. You're sharing the value. And then once you nurture those 50 people and blow them away, like they are your priority, then you ask them like, hey, do you know anyone that this community can benefit from? And like, they are then going to help you find your next 50 members. So yeah, I think that's really awesome. And there's a couple questions in here I want to give light to. Genevieve has asked about that ecosystem mapping, you know, really understanding like what are the specific elements that we're looking for when we do that map. We have shared a template in the chat, but do you have any high level elements to think about?
Yeah, the key thing was we had a lot of discussion about how we would map this. So it wasn't like we grabbed someone's framework and went, oh, let's use that. And effectively, it was scattergraph. We built several scattergraphs that had different XY axes and different bubble or shape dimensions, depending on what it was we were measuring. But what we were trying to figure out was what else was out there. So even that discipline, that process of going, what else is out there? Now, we knew that what we were going to build, you know, was nothing like a whole lot of the other things, but they didn't know that. And so what we wanted to do was not go and launch something and then have all of these folks get on a bandwagon of, you know, well, here's a government-funded thing that's going to rain on our parade, eat our lunch, take our community member, whatever it might be, right? That we did not want to create a PR disaster from the get-go. So that was one of the motivators behind this. But what it, so, you know, it was one of the motivators, but the key thing was, where do we fit? And so whenever we ran into folks that kind of, you know, start to worry about, you know, how we were going to eat their lunch, we could draw them a picture quickly on a whiteboard, have a conversation and just go, hey, you know, this is why we're different. This is why, you know, no one else is doing this. You're not doing this. Which then enabled us to have conversations about, well, maybe there's an opportunity to partner in some things or help each other. We had such a clear guiding principle and behind this, right? Our whole thing was to grow the New Zealand SaaS sector. And the reason for that was we believe that, you know, we could take the 14, 15,000 jobs that are in that sector in New Zealand at the moment, very high paying jobs, and turn that into 40 or 50,000 by 2030. And that's literally economically transformational for a nation the size of New Zealand, right? We've got the population of Sydney, right? That would make a big difference. We've already grown 10. Why don't we go and build 10? Why don't we build 15 or 20? We could literally, there's no reason we couldn't do that. And because we had a vision for where we were going and an ability to articulate why we weren't eating the lunches of others, it was a lot easier to get folks, if nothing else, to not get in our way. Right? So it was pretty powerful.
That is so powerful. And it really also highlights the importance of collaborating, not competition. Yeah. In that sense, it's like, how can we collaborate with people? How can we acknowledge people who already exist in this space and add value, not steal excellent members point from them and cause, I guess,
excellent point
concern. Yeah, no stress. Oh, Sabriah's got to head off. No worries, Sabriah. I was going to throw to you, but feel free to share your question, Sabriah, in email, and we can follow up with that afterwards. Danny, I might give you the floor. Feel free to ask your question.
Hey, Paz. Hi, Brett. I feel like I'm the Victorian equivalent of you. I work for an organisation called LaunchVic, and I'm literally trying to launch a community for regional community builders, but most of those regional community builders are local government employees. So I've a quasi-government agency trying to build a community of government people. So it's an interesting conundrum.
Very inception, yep.
So one of the biggest challenges I guess I'm finding is actually trying to find a platform to bring people together to contribute, because there's different rules about what apps and different things that government people can use on their computers. So,
yeah. Oh, yes.
So I guess I'm wondering if I guess my question being listening to what you've built and how you've gone about that, I think there's a huge amount of learnings I can take from you, and I'm wondering if there's more of your story and the kiwiSaas ins and outs that I can perhaps read or find online or yeah.
Sure. So connect on LinkedIn. I'm happy to have a conversation offline or online, but offline from this with you about all of that. And I'm quite happy to make that kind of full and frank. But just to kind of give you an overview, building these things within a government environment is an absolute freaking nightmare, right? And it's because, you know, if you think about it, the SaaS sector, I would argue, is the fastest moving sector there is nothing that moves in business as quickly, and so they've got to move quickly and break things, they've got to take risks, etc., etc. The slowest moving and most risk averse organization in any country is its government, right? And they need to be. You don't want governments moving quickly and breaking things. That's how you turn into a, you know, an Angola or something, right? So you don't want that. So that friction, that dynamic tension, is an absolute constant. We were lucky in that we had lawyers within New Zealand Trade and Enterprise, NZTE. We originated out of Callaghan Innovation. We had lawyers there. There was a lot of legal shenanigans had to go on when we were choosing platforms, when we were writing, charters and you know, codes of conduct, et cetera, et cetera, the sign-up process, who we could email, who we couldn't email. And again, Bruce Jarvis, the guy who leads kiwiSaas, he fronted most of that, and Dan Bloom, our Marcoms manager, as well. There was an inordinate amount of work went into that to make sure that lawyers were happy from a privacy perspective, from a legislative perspective, from a cybersecurity perspective. One of the things that they've done just or about to do is launch an app for kiwiSaas. So at the moment, it's a web-based portal. It's taken longer to get the legal folks and the cybersecurity folks within government happy with launching the apps than it did to build the apps, right? And that is just the nature of doing things within local, federal in your case, state government. It is the nature of the beast. But if I were to do this again, if we were to do this again, we'd probably budget a lot more time sitting in rooms talking to lawyers. But if you want to hook up, connect on LinkedIn and have a conversation about some of this stuff, I'm more than happy to do that. I'm also happy to connect you with folks in the kiwiSaas team if that makes sense too.
Oh, amazing. Thanks, Brett. Appreciate
cool. it. Oh, thanks for the question, Danny. I've just put Brett's LinkedIn link in the chat there for you. And so much fruitful conversation happening here. We've got about 5 minutes before we wrap up, cool. Brett, and we've got two questions coming your way. One is from Paulie Souza, one of our cohort CCNs, actually, and the host today. She is asking, what do you think has been the most significant impact that kiwiSaas community has had on New Zealand since its launch?
That is an excellent question. I think for the community itself, we've created the ability to have disintermediated connections happen much more easily. So in the past, it was kind of, hey, Brett, you know so-and-so, and I'd like to talk to so-and-so about such and such. Can you hook me up on LinkedIn or whatever? Now they can find each other in the platform on kiwiSaas Central and literally message directly. And what's blown me away is whenever I've made those connections in the past, and sometimes I still facilitate those conversations, not a single person has ever said no. Ever, not one. And so there's this real willingness. I'll give you a good example. Actually, there was a woman who works as a product leader outside of the SaaS sector who's very keen to get into it. And she wanted to talk to someone who was a senior product person in an established SaaS company about some of the mechanisms involved in doing that. So I connected her up with a guy who's head of product for a very well-known SaaS startup in New Zealand. It's his second rodeo. He's was involved in a very successful previous thing. No problem at all. Went and bought her a coffee, had a conversation, right? And so I think that's been a real success, that enabling this true community, people getting together and talking. The platform enables people to find on a map folks around them and contact them and, can I buy you a coffee? I'd like to pick your brains. You're doing sassy things, I'm doing sassy things, we should talk. So I think that's the first thing. But the second thing is it's enabled us to form a much clearer picture of the sector in New Zealand and start to provide some of that insight back into government. So if you could imagine what digital or tech looked like to government prior, it is, as I said, everything from zero reporting, billions of dollars in revenue through to a guy in the corner that fixes iPad screens, all of that stuff stirred in together in one pot. It's, you can look and go, oh, here's our tech sector. It's wonderful. But actually delving another layer or another layer after that deeper to, from a granularity perspective was hard. We've enabled government to do that. And there are a bunch of folks within government, public sector, and senior, in fact, even ministers prior to our recent election, who really were starting to wake up to the potential here. So there's been benefits on both sides of that equation.
I love that you're doing sassy things, and
there's a lot of funny things you can do.
Huge. Oh, for sure. That impact is huge. And back to your point before of like, how do you actually measure the impact of community? Like a lot of us here, we're all already the converted. We know that community is important. It can actually impact business strategy. It can change lives. But how do you actually quantify that? We had a really cool workshop in the cohort program with Millie Tamati from Scotland. And she was saying that, you shouldn't just measure the activity of engagement to see the broader impact that your community is having. You should be actually trying to measure the outcomes of people's lives. Like, how are you positively impacting individuals? We're not here to just measure how many people logged into Slack. Like, we want to actually have a positive difference in the world. So I love that, Brett. And I could chat to you for hours.
Just interrupt you there. That's actually a really good point. I hadn't really thought about it that way. We found it really difficult to measure engagement, or not so much measure it, but to work out, is this good or bad? Is this good engagement? You know, what constitutes engagement? Someone logs in every day. What does that mean? We're in their startup tabs. Is that a really good thing? But when you start getting feedback from folks going, look, I was having a problem and I contacted so-and-so and they stepped me through it and told me how they did, and yada, it's like that. We're having some success. So, yeah, you're right. Yeah. It's about the outputs. Outcomes.
Exactly. Well, I've got one last spicy question for you, Brett. This is a quick one. So if you had your time again and you were going to avoid doing something when you were building the community from scratch, what would that be?
That is a spicy question. That's a great question. Personally, so this is a personal thing. This is not a team thing. This is a personal thing. I would have chosen a different platform. And that's not to rain on Hivebright's parade. I think what I learned, and this is, I'm coming at this from a very selfish perspective. Every platform has its pluses and minuses. And I've spoken to people that use all of the platforms and they all have their pluses and minuses. For me, I found it really challenging to understand at an individual level what was going on. I wanted to understand, you know, when I did this, who was responding? You know, I wanted a heat map of who the most engaged folks were, who were the ones that were messaging others more. And I found that challenging, virtually impossible to get. And I'm not sure there's really any platform that would do it. So if I was going to do anything again, it would be to, you need the platform, the front end, the stuff that everyone sees. But I think to really understand the importance of having something that helps you at literally an individual level understand what's pushing their buttons. And when we publish this stuff, these folks really, really react, but these folks don't. When we do this, those folks do and those folks don't. To start to be able to do some testing and understand what's working, what's sticking, that was a challenge. So that's one thing. There's probably 100 things I'd do differently, but I'd probably pick up the Millington book a month or two earlier. That would have been quite helpful. That's a great question. That is nice. Such a good question. I'm going to steal that for future things.
You can steal it. We're collaborators, not competitors.
Oh, it's already stolen. Brett, don't worry. So you can...
Okay. Awesome. Yeah. I'll trademark it later then. that sounds great, Brett. We actually posted 23 copies of Rich Millington's book literally last weekend to our cohort crew members, and he was our guest speaker.
He's a rock star.
The whole thing on its head. So. Yeah, he's doing some incredible work. So everyone should definitely connect with him. But Brett, I've got to wrap it there. I've got to pass it back to Paulie. So just on behalf of everyone here, just thank you so much for all of that wisdom, for taking time out of your schedule to energize and inspire and motivate all of us here. So a massive round of applause. Please, everyone, connect with Brett, check him out, send him a LinkedIn message about one thing you took away from this session. Exactly. And now I'm going to pass it back to the incredible Paulie, who's going to close out the session.
Thank you so much, Paz. And thank you so much, Brett. I think that my biggest takeaway is that you need to map out what's out there, because it's not only going to help you find where you fit, but also can help you to frame your value proposition better. So it's been an amazing talk. Thank you so much, Brett. Looking forward to catch up with you later if we have the time. We would also love to hear your feedback and takeaways from today. So Paz is going to share a link to our survey, ladies, so we can get your feedback. Feedback is a blessing. So the more feedback we get, the better we can get. So please make sure you share your takeaways and feedback. And you, at the end, you will also get access to the guest list, resources, and, of course, the group photo. Plus, if you like more support as a community builder, be sure to sign up to so you can hear when is our community cohort number 4 program launches in 2024. It's an 8-week program, super highly recommended if you want to learn all about how to measure value, the community, how to frame it, frame your work, and a lot of amazing tools you're going to learn over these 8 weeks. So it's definitely designed to get you, to help you to become a better community builder. We also have a few amazing upcoming meetups. We're partnering with a few organizations to keep the party going with fellow community builders. So we're gonna have our meetup number 25 about community engagement tactics. MoveJocks and the Community Collective are partnering in Auckland. So if you're around in Auckland on the 22nd of November, we would love to have you over to listen to stories about community builders. And then Stone and Shock and the Community Collective end of the year party is happening in Melbourne. I have such a FOMO for that one because it's going to be a good one. So if you're in Melbourne, please make sure you go there. I think that's pretty much from today. Thank you so much for your love and kindness, and looking forward to connect with you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, everyone. And thank you, Paulie, for being an incredible host. And have a great day, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, Brett.
Cool. That was fun. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Listen, baby. Ain't no mountain high. Ain't no valley low. Ain't no river wide enough, baby.
If you need me, call me. No matter where you are. No matter how far.
Don't worry, baby.
Just call my name. I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry. Cause baby, there ain't no mountain high enough.
I think as far back as I can remember hearing music and hearing people sing and perform, I just knew that it's what I wanted to do, so I started singing in church.